وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِّمَّنْ دَعَا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who deserves ultimate praise. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to send His salat and salam upon the one that He has chosen to be rahmatan lil alameen, our Nabi and Rasul, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Today's Q&A is actually going to be a rather lengthy answer. It's going to be only one question. And it is with regards to zakat on 401ks, zakat on retirement funds. This is a question that I have been asked by many dozens of people, and I've actually given previous lectures about this. So today, inshallah, we're going to go into a little bit of detail about whether zakat should be given and how much should be given and how do we calculate zakat on retirement funds. Now, before we begin, I need to point out that this is a topic dealing with Islamic finance. And as I have said many, many times, modern Islamic finance is actually a very new field. It's a very interesting field. It is a field that has a lot of diversity and a lot of different opinions. And I do not claim to be an expert on Islamic finance, far from it. I follow those that are senior to me. So in today's lecture, I will be quoting scholars more senior to me, and I will be taking the position that is advocated by some of my teachers and also the Fiqh Council of North America, but I have utmost respect for the other positions out there, and it is up to you obviously to choose your authority. You should realize that there is a spectrum of opinion, and we will be going into those opinions. Now, for those of you that do not want to listen to the entire lecture, it's going to be too long for you, the quick and short answer is that the position that I will be advocating, which is the position that is the Fiqh Council of North America, and also the position of our teacher Shaykh Salah Al-Sawi, the founder of Amja, and a number of other senior scholars of this land, is that 401k and all retirement funds that are basically based in North America or in America in particular, that zakat is due on the amount, not of the paper amount, but rather the amount that you can withdraw after taxes and after penalties. So whatever the amount might be on paper, that's one thing. Then suppose you were to withdraw that amount. Suppose you put in the paperwork and you signed all the forms and you insisted that you want to get that amount back. That amount is not going to be the paper amount. You're going to first take the penalty away, and then you're going to take this taxes away. Once you have done that, you get a significantly lesser amount, maybe by 30-40%. So that amount that is remaining, zakat is due on that amount annually. This is the position of a number of scholars, and also the position of the Fiqh Council of North America. Do realize there are other positions as well, and we'll be explaining them bit by bit, inshallah ta'ala. Another caveat as well, today's lecture is about the United States of America in particular, because retirement funds vary from country to country. And so if people are watching from another country, they should ask the scholars of those lands and the Fiqh councils of those lands, because retirement funds are something that are country specific and change from place to place, and therefore the fatwa or the fiqh will also change from place to place. So with that, let us begin. I actually have a brief PowerPoint as well that I was giving a talk somewhere, so I prepared this PowerPoint for them. That retirement funds in America, they are primarily of two types. You have the employee sponsored and you have the individual retirement account. And of course, the individual retirement account, this is the self-sponsored. And of course, this is the IRA or the IRA. And this is divided into two primary ones, the Roth and the traditional. And the main point here, when you're dealing with an IRA, you are the one putting the money into the retirement. Nobody else is putting that money in, and there is no employer that is going to also be putting in some of the money into the fund. You alone are going to be the person that is putting the money. That's why it's called individual IRA, the individual retirement account. And there is no matching amount. That's anybody else puts. What you put is what is in the fund. And this is divided into two categories, the Roth IRA and the traditional IRA. And as for the Roth IRA, so the Roth IRA, you have already paid your taxes from your salary, and you are now putting your money into the IRA or the IRA after paying your taxes. And therefore, when you cash out, there is not going to be any taxes to pay. So the Roth IRA or the Roth IRA, you have already paid the taxes. So suppose your salary is $80,000. Let's make it easier, $100,000, right? Your salary is $100,000 and you want to finance your retirement fund with the Roth IRA. So from your salary, it's now in your pocket, you will write a check to your retirement fund. You have already been taxed. The tax amount you will pay to Uncle Sam that year. And you will then add an amount into your retirement fund. Because you've already been taxed, you will not be taxed again when you want to cash out. That is the Roth IRA. As for the traditional IRA, that is a fund where you can invest before you pay taxes to Uncle Sam. So the income that you're going to get, you can say, oh, I want to put this amount into the traditional IRA. And therefore, you will be taxed when you cash out whenever you retire. So the difference is in taxation. And therefore, the Roth IRA, there is no penalty, there is no taxes for taking the money out. And also, when it comes to the Roth IRA as well, that the Roth IRA allows you to withdraw any amount that you have invested without even taxes or even a penalty. If you have invested that amount, you are allowed to withdraw it without any taxes or penalty. You have much easier access than the other funds. This is the individual retirement amount, the IRA. As for the employee sponsored is of multiple types. What we're really primarily interested in is a 401k. As for the 403b and the 457s and others, frankly, it doesn't matter to us as the end user. It's only between the corporations themselves which one works better for their internal tax purposes. It doesn't really change the fiqh at all, because from the user's perspective, fiqh-wise, it is exactly the same. Now, what is the key point here of the employee-sponsored 401ks is that two things are at play. First and foremost, that the employer sponsored. Firstly, the employer, your company, is going to give a matching donation, a matching amount. So if you give $10,000, the employer, it's going to be in your contract. What is going to be the maximum amount the employer is going to give? The employer might say, I'll also give $10,000. So you are essentially doubling the amount without you actually paying that amount. You're going to pay $10,000, the employer adds $10,000, and it goes to the retirement fund as $20,000. And that is a bonus or something that the employer is a part of the package that is giving. And secondly, when it comes to company sponsored, in that case, you are not writing a check, it is being deducted from your paycheck. So you never actually see the money. So you get the check, and the check already has withdrawn from it. There's already an amount taken, and that amount is going straight to the 401k. So you don't actually see the money yourself, it is going straight to the fund. Now, for our purposes, we can also assume that generally speaking, the penalties, so there is a penalty to withdraw in the traditional IRA, and also in the employer-sponsored, the Roth and the traditional 401k, there is a penalty to withdraw. You cannot withdraw before your retirement age. Generally speaking, the penalty is around 10%. Or sometimes you have to pay the money back more, and sometimes the amount is deducted from the amount that you withdraw. So if you wanted to withdraw $100,000, you actually end up withdrawing $90,000. $10,000 is just a penalty just because you wanted to early withdraw. So in most of these programs, there is limited access because you cannot withdraw without a penalty until you reach the retirement age. Retirement age is generally 59 and a half. And so until you reach 59 and a half, if you wanted to withdraw, there will be a penalty in all of these other than the Roth IRA. The Roth IRA, there will be no penalty, because remember we explained the mechanism of how that works. Along with this, there will also be taxes in your average 401k. And so the taxes are going to be, again, if you didn't pay taxes when you first invested, which is the default. Most people have a traditional 401k, and a traditional 401k is that you will be taxed when you pull out, okay? The difference between the traditional 401 and the Roth 401, again, the Roth 401 is that you are taxed when you invest. So you're not going to be taxed when you pull out. The traditional 401, and if you're already confused, then this is just the beginning, Allah musta'an. The traditional 401 is the default in most corporations in the United States of America. It is the traditional 401k. The traditional 401k, you do not pay taxes when you put the money in. You will pay taxes when you pull the money out. And you will also pay a penalty if you pull it out before your retirement age. Okay, this is, in a nutshell, the main retirement funds in America. Now, before we move on, one important point. Most countries, or I should say many countries in the Middle East, they have a very different form of retirement. America does not have an IRA or an employer-sponsored retirement that is obligatory. There is nothing that is obligatory in that list. Nowhere in the United States of America are you forced to enter into a retirement program like a 401k or an IRA. That's something you choose to do. In many Middle Eastern countries, the government has a special fund that is dedicated for retirement. And the government, and especially government employees, if you're an employee from the government will, whether you like it or not, will automatically enroll you into the mandatory retirement fund. Your paycheck will be deducted whether you want to or not, and you do not have any access to that money until you retire. Now, I'm saying this point because the fatwa that most scholars from those lands say is that zakat is not due on retirement funds. And they are absolutely correct. But I want you to understand, when a scholar in the Middle East says retirement funds are not zakatable, I just invented a word, zakatable, when the retirement funds are not zakatable, he is not talking about 401ks. He cannot be talking about 401ks. If you are not asked whether you want to join the program or not, if it is mandatory, if you never see the money, and it wasn't your choice to not see the money, and you have no access to the money, if you wanted it for a medical emergency, you could not get it, well then, definitely you will not pay zakat on the money you never had, you never voluntarily gave up, and you have no access to. And therefore, all of the fatawa that come from the lands that have mandatory retirement accounts, please understand, those fatawa do not and cannot apply to 401ks or to IRAs. We need people who have looked at these retirement funds, and just because we say the IRA is a retirement fund, and in, you know, the Kuwait or in Bahrain or whatever, I'm just giving an example, or in Jordan there's a retirement fund, just because the fatwa comes from that land says retirement fund, it doesn't mean it applies to the 401k, because it is a completely separate reality altogether. Okay, so with that caveat in mind, we need to have fatwa from ulama that have looked at the North American contracts, that have looked at the reality of this situation. And before I move on, I want you to understand that there is a massive amount of wealth in retirement funds. Look at the statistics on the amount of wealth in retirements that, according to the Investment Company Institute, which is one of the main institutes that does this type of research in North America, the total U.S. retirement assets were around $28 trillion in 2020. That is 28 followed by 12 zeros. I want you to understand this, because when you say whether we should or should not give zakah, you are talking about a fortune. You are talking about a massive amount of wealth. And you need to think about the repercussions of saying, oh, no zakah or zakah. This is more than the GDP of many countries in the world. And the claim that there should be no zakah, you are basically then, and again, you can already see my sympathies that there is going to be zakat. You are saying that this massive amount of wealth should just be there and there should be no zakat on it whatsoever. Look at the next chart over here, that the statistics of retirement in America. And this is by Vanguard, that on average, you see the chart over here, the average and the median amounts. And of course, you know, you should all know the difference between the average and the median, that you see over here that the average 401k balance, obviously it increases over time. And when you reach in your 60s, around 200,000 is the average 401k. And of course, the median is of course less than that, because obviously you're taking into account different statistics. So there's quite a lot of wealth here. And again, look at Ameritrade, another company that is dealing with 401ks. That Ameritrade did a survey of 50 to 59 year olds, and Ameritrade is doing a survey of its own in its own users. And they gave this statistic here, that 37% have less than 50,000 saved, 16% have 50 to 99,000 saved, 32%, one third, this is where the majority are, one third have around half a million or less than half a million, from 1 to 500,000. So one third of the people who use this particular company, when they're in their 50s, they have this amount of wealth. 6% have more than half a million, but less than 1 billion. And 8% have more than 1 million in their retirement account. And again, this is just to give you a snapshot or a survey of the average statistics. Again, we need to understand what we are dealing with, right? We have a principle in the Sharia that, you know, understanding the situation is half the problem or half the fatwa. Before you give the fatwa, you need to understand what is going on in the country and in the world and in the context that you are giving the fatwa in. Fidelity, which is one of the largest investment, actually it is the largest investment corporation in North America. And in fact, it holds the largest quantity of 401k accounts. Over 16 million 401k accounts are held by Fidelity, and it is consistently ranked as the largest defined contribution from this firm, that on average, the average of all of its 16 million accounts was around $103,000 as of last year. So we clearly have an immense amount of wealth. Again, imagine 16 million times 100,000. Again, we're talking about a massive amount of wealth. Now, the question then arises that should zakat be given on these funds? Now, before we get to this issue, again, I don't need to remind you of the importance of zakat. I don't need to remind you, even though we should all be aware of this, or something that we all know. Zakat is one of the fundamental pillars of our faith. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala links zakat and salah multiple times, many dozens of times in the Quran. الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ لِلزَّكَاةِ فَاعِلُونَ. And it is one of the fundamental economic pillars of our faith. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that one of the goals of Islamic finance is that money not be kept dormant. لِكَيْ لَا يَكُونَ دُولَةً بَيْنَ الْأَغْنِيَاءِ مِنْكُمْ. This is a very key phrase of the Quran, so that wealth doesn't remain just a plaything amongst the rich that they keep on transferring. It should not remain just locked up and not, you know, utilized. And therefore, of course, the hadith of Jibreel, the famous hadith of zakat, the hadith in Sahih Bukhari, that whoever does not pay zakat, the very wealth that he did not pay zakat on will come and punish him in the fire of hell. If he didn't pay zakat on gold, it will be melted and it will be poured on him. If he didn't pay zakat on his sheep and his goats and his oxen and his cows, they will trample over him for 50,000 years, etc., etc. The notion of those who are not paying zakat will be from the people of the fire of hell. And very important, brothers and sisters, when the Prophet ﷺ passed away and a group of early converts decided, we're not going to pay zakat, we don't have to pay zakat, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq considered them to be murtad. Now, of course, I'm not saying that the 401k position is it. I'm saying the importance of zakah. Whether a faqih, a scholar, decides that there is zakah or not in 401k has nothing to do with this incident, so don't conflate the two. But I'm saying the importance of zakah, that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anh, he and the unanimous consensus of the sahaba was that anybody who denies the obligation of zakah, that person is not going to be considered a Muslim. Zakah is one of the fundamental pillars of our faith. And the purpose of zakah, it's not just haqq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's also the haqq of the fuqara. There's also the haqq of the poor people. And there is nothing that demonstrates this better than the fact that the yateen, the orphan, that zakat is due on the money of the orphan. But the orphan is not going to give, he's too young. So the guardian of the orphan gives. You see, a lot of people say, oh, but giving zakat is difficult on the wealth that we have. And they have $100,000, $150,000, and they say, oh, I don't want to, you know, give zakat on this amount. And we remind them that imagine somebody who's lost his mother and father. Imagine somebody who has $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 that the mother, father left them, and now a distant cousin is taking care of this young child. This amount, imagine we are obliged to give zakat on the amount that belongs to the orphan every year until the orphan becomes of age, then we hand him over. And if we do not give zakat, the orphan is not sinful, it's not his fault. The guardian will be sinful. If we are, because why? Because there's the haqq of the orphan, but there's also the haqq of the poor people. There's the haqq of the poor people. The money is just sitting there doing nothing. You should give 2.5%. That's all that it is, 2.5%. We're talking about if the wealth is obviously available, gold, silver, whatnot, or sitting in a bank account, then you should take 2.5% and then give it to the fuqara until the orphan comes of age. Then he can do as he pleases or she pleases with that amount. Now, when it comes to whether one should give zakat on 401ks or not, there are two main factors, there are two main factors that we need to take into account. How we answer both of these factors will dictate whether we say there is zakat or not. And it is because scholars answer these two questions differently that they reach different conclusions. Okay, so there are many opinions about zakat on 401k, and the scholars that are arguing for all of these various opinions, it all goes back to how they answer these two questions. What are the two questions? Number one, do you actually technically have ownership? In Arabic, it's called milkiya. Are you actually the owner of this amount of money? Do you have milkiya tamma? Do you have full ownership? Or do you not have full ownership, and therefore, because you don't have ownership, then you're not going to give zakat on it? Obviously, if you don't own it, then you're not going to give zakat on it. So any scholar who argued that you do not have milkiya, it's called milkiya, you do not have milkiya, then they said, obviously, if you don't own it, you don't give zakat on it. Obviously, right? That makes sense. So the first question we have to answer is that, is there milkiya? Is there ownership over the 401k? And the second question is that, if we answer no, then khalas, end of story. The chapter is closed and we move on. Because if there's no ownership, there's no zakat, obviously. The owner gives the zakat, or the one who's the guardian of the owner. So for example, the orphan does not give zakat, the milkiya is his, but there is a guardian, and the guardian is responsible to maintain the money, to protect the money, and to give zakat on the money. So the guardian of the milkiya also has to give zakat. But the point is that if there is no milkiya, I don't own the money, it's my friend's money, my cousin's money, if it's the corporation's money, why would I give zakat? It's not my money in the first place. So is there milkiya? The second question that needs to be asked, and this is the more convoluted one, is that how does one calculate zakat on long-term investments? Okay, that is two separate questions. So the first question, is there milkiya? Is there ownership? The second question, what is the correct opinion about how zakat is calculated on long-term investments? So let us break this down with the first question and then the second question. Now, the first question, and that is that issue of ownership, of milkiya. And the argument of our teachers, of Sheikh Salah al-Sawi, and of the Fiqh Council and of other great ulama, is that there is ownership of the 401k. The person who is investing is the owner, and there should be no controversy over this point. In other words, milkiya is established. There can be no controversy over this point. And the issue of milkiya is established. It is very clear. Why is it clear? Well, because you are the one who signed up for the account. Nobody forced you to get into the 401k or to start an IRA. Nobody can force you in America. If you don't want the 401k, you can tell your employer, I don't want it, and you can not get involved. You chose to sign into the 401k. The 401k is in your name. It is under your social security number. And therefore, we have to be very clear here that because it is a voluntary signing up, and because you decided to enter into the contract, and because you had the option of not entering into the contract, you clearly have the milkiya. You're the one who took that right or that money and then said, invest it over there. Now, One of the points that is said is that I don't have the right to حق التصرف. حق التصرف. There's no right of تصرف. تصرف means right to do as I please. In other words, حق التصرف here would mean I want to invest in this fund rather than that fund. Okay, now generally speaking, your company, your 401k, if you are working for a very large company, they might give you a portfolio. You can choose. If you're working for a small company, maybe they don't even have that. They're going to force it on you. This is the only 401k that we have. By and large, you cannot choose the individual stocks and the options that are there for the 401k. It's on a platter and you choose from that platter if you're able to. And sometimes you're not even able to choose. So the point is that you don't have what is called حق التصرف. You don't have the right to do with it as you please. It's not like cash in your pocket. It's not like your checking's bank account. There are checks on there. No, I shouldn't say checks, it's going to be confusing. There are certain restrictions on how you can manage that wealth. The response to this is that the fact that you don't have the type of access you do on your checkings does not negate the fact that you own. And an example can be given here that if you owned a house and you gave the house on rent and there are tenants living in that house, you do not have the right to barge into that house anytime you want, even though it is your house and you own it. Nobody's going to deny you're the owner, but you have given up some of the rights that are otherwise yours because you have tenants over here. You chose to give that up and now you have a different contract where there are tenants and you cannot just barge in. There are people living there. It's haram for you to barge into your house in your name because there are other people living there. So you have given up a type of ownership, you have given up a type of tasarruf or a type of action that would otherwise be allowed for you because you have entered into another contract. The point being that the 401ks are similarly, in the same way, that you have chosen to give up that right to do with that money as you please. So the fact that there is no حق التصرف does not negate the milkiyah, is what I'm trying to say. In other words, the milkiyah is still yours. The second claim that is said, that shows you that there's no milkiyah, the other group says that there's no milkiyah, they say that, oh, but hold on a sec, the amount is not fully accessible. That if there's 100,000 in the 401k, then I don't have access to that 100,000. I have to give the penalty of 10%, and then I have to give taxes, and the taxes might even be 35%. So what I end up with might actually be maybe 60,000 out of the 100,000. So this clearly shows that I don't own the 100,000. And the response to this is that the argument that is being made is that zakat is due on what is accessible. It is not due on the full amount. Zakat is due on what you will actually be able to get out of it. Therefore, the notion that you don't have the full amount available, we say you're absolutely right, and that is why you don't pay zakat on the full amount. But to claim that just because I don't have 100% access, this means I don't pay 100% zakat, no. If you have access to 70%, then you give zakat on 70%. So once again, this issue is then shown to be null and void, that simply because you do not have full access does not negate ownership. The third thing is that it says there is no immediate access, okay? There is no immediate access. In other words, it's not like the money is in my cash, my checkings. I can just write a check. It's not like the money is in my pocket. Rather, it is restricted. And the response is, the access is not unreasonable. All you need to do is to fill out some forms, to wait a week or two, and you will get access to that amount. In other words, the fact that there is a technicality that you'll have to wait a while, fill out two forms. And the key point that really shows that you have ownership is that no third party can deny your request to get that money. There's not going to be a middleman that's going to look at your form and say, oh, is this emergency good enough for me to give you or not? So your boss or your employer might say, are you sure you want to withdraw? And you say, yes, I'm sure. Okay, it's your business. This demonstrates you are the owner. Nobody can tell you after you fill out the form, I don't think that's a good enough excuse. No, you have the right to withdraw. Because you have the right to withdraw, therefore, there is no doubt you are the ultimate owner because you have that access. Now the fact that withdrawing is going to take two forms or three forms, you have to fill out, you have to get sign it and throw it, or not throw it, submit it and wait 2-3 weeks, that doesn't mean anything. So what? Imagine if you had a bank vault, you know, the physical vaults in the bank, that you had rented a box in a bank and you moved state and you kept your box in the other state and that box has gold bars in it. Are you going to say, oh, I have to drive 6 hours to the other state to get that and I have to go only on the weekday, it's closed on the weekends, so because there's not immediate access, I don't have to pay zakat on the gold bars? Obviously not. The extra hassle of driving to that other state and opening the box does not absolve you from the necessity to pay zakat on the gold bars that you owe. Therefore, similarly, the fact that you don't have immediate access does not negate the fact that you actually do have access, and therefore zakat is going to be due every single year. And then the final point that is mentioned, and of course this is a summary as with all lectures of mine, you can always go more and more. The final point that is mentioned is that there is a penalty to access this wealth. And so they say that because there is a penalty, so I don't have, this is not milkiya. And the response is that the penalty is from the withdrawal amount and not from your own pocket. In other words, you do not have to pay money to get your 401k. Rather, the 401k is going to have a 10%, usually it's a 10%, sometimes it's more than this. The 401k might have a 10% penalty, and therefore if on paper it is 100,000, the amount you're going to withdraw is going to be 90,000. And then you're going to pay taxes, and so it might get down to, you know, 60,000 or 70,000. So all of this is something that it doesn't negate the fact that you own the money. The bottom line is that there can be no serious debate over the issue of ownership. And the two strongest points for this are the following. Number one, no one can come between you and that money, or at least a portion of it if you wanted it. And this is a clear indication that you own the money. No one can deny you if you wanted it. Yes, there might be penalties. Yes, there might be taxes, but a large amount is eventually going to come to your pocket whenever you desire it, after a week or two or whenever. That clearly indicates it is yours. Number two, were you to die, then the money will eventually go to your spouse and your children. So the money will be inherited by your heirs. And this clearly indicates it is your money. If it were not your money, your heirs would not inherit it. Therefore, bottom line, the first question, is there milkiya of the 401k? And the response is, there is clearly a milkiya, and that milkiya is enough to warrant that zakat be given. We now move on to the second question, and this is really where it gets complicated. The second question, which really a specialist can give many hours of lectures on, I'm not going to do that because firstly, I'm not a specialist, and secondly, this is not the point that we're here. But this question really dictates the correct opinion about 401k, and that is, what is the correct fiqhi position of zakat on long-term investments? And here is where we get a number of opinions. So what is a long-term investment, a long-term mutual fund, a long-term stock? So to be very simplistic, and again, here's the problem. You have to be simplistic, and the real world is never that simple. People who are actually engaged in this might be in the middle or whatnot. But let's be very simplistic. Scenario A is a person who's investing and monitoring actively. Okay, he wants to see when the markets are going to rise, or he invests in, you know, Tesla right now, okay, a very hot stock or whatnot. And so he wants to see, is it going up, going down, monitoring day by day. This type of investment, generally speaking, our scholars say that there will be zakat on the full amount the day of your annual zakat. So if your zakat is the first of Ramadan, come first of Ramadan, you will pay 2.5%. Now, suppose you have a mutual fund. I'm giving an example, a long term. You're not monitoring the amount, and you're not really worried about the rise and fall. You're not intending to sell anytime. You're saving it for a rainy day. Okay, you're saving it for a rainy day. This is what we talk about when we say the zakat on long-term investments. A long-term investment is an investment you do not plan to cash out anytime soon. It's an investment you're saving for a future event or a rainy day. This is called a long-term investment. And it's this is where we find three opinions of the ulama of our times. The first opinion, which is a very minority opinion, is that there is no zakat whatsoever on long-term investment. And this is the position of just a handful of scholars, and frankly, without going into a lot of detail, but really there doesn't seem to be, it really does not make sense. I mean, you can have millions of dollars just saved we're talking about obviously an investment, a mutual fund or a stock that you're not planning to sell. We're not talking about cash in your bank account. We're talking about an actual investment that you have done, a portfolio, a mutual fund, a stock that you have put into and you're not monitoring. So one group, a small group of ulama, said there's no zakat on it, and they have the reasons to do so. And I, with utmost respect, I strongly disagree that it doesn't make sense. You can have millions of dollars and you'll say, oh, but I have a long-term investment. The other two opinions really have weight. Both of them are very good positions, and both of them are strongly debated in modern fiqh councils. And depending on where you go with this question, then you get the 401k's specific answers. The second opinion is the exact opposite of the first, and that is that you pay zakat on the full amount, and this is and it will be considered to be what is called in Arabic urud al-tijara. Zakat is due on four different types of wealth. The fourth one, the last one, being urud al-tijara. Urud al-tijara is your business inventory. What is a business inventory? So anything that you buy and sell for the sake of buying and selling, for the sake of money and wealth, anything that you deal in, you trade with as your daily profession, as your means of earning money, this is called urud al-tijara. The simple example I can give you is furniture salesman. He owns a furniture shop, right? And so the inventory of the furniture in the furniture shop, this is urud al-tijara. And on the day of zakah, he must calculate the cost of the inventory that is at hand and give 2.5%, whatever it might be. This is called urud al-tijara. Now, the furniture in his house, no zakat. The furniture in his warehouse, zakat. You see the difference between the two, right? Why? Because the furniture in his house is being used, and there is no zakat on the items that you use. There's no zakat on your car. There's no zakat on your house that you live in. There's no zakat on the furniture that you're using. But if you're a car salesman and you have a car lot and you have 50 cars for sale and it goes up and down, some days you have 40, some days you have 80, some days you have 10, then you just keep on going with the cycle. And the day that you calculate your zakah, every one of us should have one day of the year that we calculate our zakah. The day that you calculate your zakah, on that day, whatever is the quantity of cars, you simply calculate it out and you give 2.5%. If it so happens it's 90 cars, you give zakat 2.5% of the wealth of 90 cars. And if it just so happens it's 10 cars, the day before somebody comes and purchases 80, 90 cars, mashallah, tabarakallah, that's your qadr. You didn't do anything intentionally. The point being, urud al-tijara is zakatable by unanimous, but not unanimous consensus, by the four schools of law. The Zahiri say it's not, but the four schools of law say that it is zakatable. So this opinion, the second opinion, says that a long-term investment takes the ruling of urud al-tijara. Okay, a long-term investment, because eventually you want to cash out. So imagine if you're a warehouse dealer, you're a furniture dealer, and you have inventory in your warehouse, and you have inventory in your showroom. Okay, the fact that you don't have the warehouse in the showroom doesn't mean that you don't give zakat on the warehouse. It's still inventory and it is intending to be sold. And therefore, based on this position, the fatwa would basically be that the zakat is going to be due on the amount that is there. The third opinion is a little bit more complicated. And this is the position of a number of modern fiqh councils of the world. Also, it is the position of my teacher, Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen, and others. And that is that long-term investments, we look at the company and we look at what it is doing. And so, if the company is dealing in tangible goods that are sold, then we give zakat on that company. And if the zakat is dealing in services or intellectual property, then there will be no zakat on that. Now, this is a little bit more complicated. So basically, if Google is only doing online services, even though it's not, but I'm saying if Google were to only do online services, and if Tesla were to only be selling cars, according to this position, if you have a mutual fund that has both Tesla and Google, I'm just giving examples again, I'm not advising anybody to do anything, I'm just saying, according to that position, they would say zakat should be given on the Tesla amount of the stock and not on the Google if these caveats were there. I should actually not use exact company names because you might tell me that Google has this and that. So I'm giving the caveat. If the company deals in actual buying and selling of merchandise of material, they would say zakat is due 2.5%. And if the company is an intellectual company dealing with online stuff, dealing with services, dealing with like for example the hotel that it's selling a service, and that is to rent rooms out, right? It's not buying and selling anything, it's selling a service. According to this fatwa, which is a popular fatwa as well, that zakat will only be due on a percentage of the investment depending on the type of investment. That means this group is going to say, go through your entire portfolio and separate that which is zakatable versus that which is not zakatable. And if you're not able to do that, they will give you a generic percentage. This leads us now to the actual fatawas that exist. When I say previous fatawa, I mean previous to what we are going to decide in the meeting. I was in a meeting, we're talking about this, so I'm saying there have been a number of fatawa in this in the 401k. So look at this list over here. These are actual fatawa from North American scholars about 401ks and investment funds. All five of them exist. And you notice there's a big spectrum of opinion. The first fatwa is that zakat is due annually on the entire amount, the actual paper amount. So when you get your statement in the mail and it says your 401k is $100,000, the value, this fatwa will say you therefore pay $2,500. Right then and there, just the paper amount. That is fatwa number one. A number of ulama have said this, but frankly, there are not that many in number. The second fatwa is the fatwa that is the Fiqh Council of North America, and it is Sheikh Salah Al-Sawi from Amja, and it is, I would say, one of the mainstream fatwa, and that is that zakat is due annually on the amount after taxes and penalties, okay? So you get your paper statement of 100,000 in the mail, you deduct, first and foremost, the penalty. Then you deduct the taxes were you to cash the entire amount out. What is remaining is your potential wealth that you have access to if you desired to do so. The second fatwa is that zakat is due on that amount, not on the full amount, whatever is the second amount. The third fatwa is that zakat is due on the zakat liable assets after taxes and penalties. Now, if you go back to this slide here, you see what I said here. You see these two opinions here, right? That zakat is due on the full amount and zakat is due on the type of investment, okay? Depending on which of these two positions you follow. If you follow the third opinion, that zakat depends on the type of investment, you will then follow the third opinion over here. Zakat is due annually on the zakat liable assets after taxes and penalties. And therefore, you will not pay zakat on the amount after taxes and penalties. You will pay zakat on a portion of the assets after taxes and penalties. What is that portion? Technically, you're supposed to calculate each and every fund separately. One of our scholars, one of the fatwa councils of England, estimated 25%, and one of our scholars here in North America, our dear teacher and dear mentor, Sheikh Hatim Al-Hajj, he estimated one third of this. And so he said that one third of the amount of number two, so there's a big difference between number two and number three, right? Whatever is number two, he said one third of that you give zakat on, based on this fatwa over here, the second versus the third opinion, is that what is the zakat of long-term investment? And Dr. Hatim Al-Hajj's position is that zakat is dependent on the type of investment. And again, it's a very valid position, and I respect that position immensely, but it is not the position of the Fiqh Council. The Fiqh Council went with number two. There are other scholars that have basically said there is no zakat due at all. And then they differed. Some of them said until retirement age, in which case there will be no penalty. And if you choose to remain and keep it in there, you should pay zakat annually because it's your choice. And there are even some scholars that have said that zakat is not due until one actually withdraws, even after retirement age. And so, of course, the difference between 4 and 5 should be clear. That suppose you are 67 years old, mashallah, tabarakallah, and the retirement age is 59 and a half. According to fatwa number 4, you will be paying zakat for 7 years. When you're 60, 61, 62, 60, every single year you are paying zakat. Even if you did not withdraw, because you have the opportunity to withdraw and you chose not to withdraw without penalty, and therefore you will be paying zakat. And then the fifth opinion is basically saying, no, if he's 67 and the 401k is still active and he hasn't cashed out, then it's his business and he is not going to pay zakat at all. Now, with my utmost respect and love to the ulama that said positions 4 and 5, I think that it is simply unfeasible because you are creating what is essentially a zakat shelter, a zakat haven, just like there are tax shelters and tax havens, right? That you can accrue an immense amount of wealth in the 401k and then shrug your shoulder and say, oh, I don't have liquid cash to pay $500,000 amount of the 401k. I don't have zakat money. And you have $500,000. And the poor guy starving on the street, or the poor orphan is not taken care of, and the poor, you know, Muslim brother or sister doesn't have a house over his head, cannot pay the rent. And you're like, oh, I'm sorry, my $500,000 401k, I don't want to touch it because I want a cushy retirement. There is a haq for that poor person as well. And I am not that sympathetic, even though I respect the ulama, and I'm saying they have an argument, they have a basis. It's not as if they're coming out of thin air. They have ways to validate this, but I really think that common sense dictates that you cannot just be sitting on a fortune and say, I'm sorry, I can't give zakat because I want to have a cushy retirement. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted cushy retirements, the yateem has the utmost responsibility that his wealth be taken care of. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, even for the yateem, that his zakat should be given on behalf of the wali. So how about somebody who has, mashallah tabarakallah, a large amount? Now, Allah knows best. Really, the positions that I am very sympathetic towards are both number 2 and number 3. Look at your chart here. Number 1 to me makes no sense at all. And again, I'm using harsh terminology, but utmost respect and love. Number 1 and number 4 and number 5 just don't make any sense to me. Why? Because number 1, how can you pay zakat on the full amount when you don't own the full amount? You just don't, because you have a penalty and you have the taxes. So then how can you pay for money that you don't actually own? So to pay zakat on the full amount does not make sense to me. You don't have access to the full amount. You will only pay after the taxes and the penalty. Now, the Roth IRA, for example, that might be, you can say, okay, the full amount is indeed the full amount. That's something else. But otherwise, if there will be taxes and penalties, it does not make sense to pay zakat on an amount that you will never get at that point in time. Number 4 and 5, I already explained, it doesn't make sense to me because every year your retirement fund is going to grow bigger and bigger and bigger, and you will not pay one penny of zakat, and that does not make any sense to me. Between 2 and 3, honestly, whichever position you follow, I understand fully and I'm very sympathetic towards. My teacher Shaykh Hatim Al-Hajj is on position number 2. My teacher Shaykh Salah Hasawi is on position number, sorry, my teacher Shaykh Hatim Al-Hajj is on position number 3. And my teacher Shaykh Salah Hasawi is on position number 2. And the Fiqh Council of North America, which I am a executive member of, the Fiqh Council of North America has decided to go with number 2. Zakat is due annually on the amount after taxes and penalties. And I have no qualms in saying that whoever follows position number 2 will have more barakah in their lives, because the more, remember, yahi, you're not giving zakat to the poor for no reason. You're giving it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qad aflaha man zakaha. Giving zakat will bring about peace and will bring about blessings and will bring about Allah's barakah. There's no question that the second opinion will be more blessed and your wealth will grow, because our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave a qasam. He swore by Allah that giving zakat does not diminish one's charity. So the conclusion that I have is that the default is that retirement plans in America are optional and voluntary, And you are choosing to get in, unlike in many Middle Eastern countries, because there's clear ownership, milkiyah, you clearly have milkiyah. And because this is clearly a type of wealth that is meant to generate more income, this is a point I didn't get into, it's called al-mal al-nami, which is that wealth generating, it's not just stagnant wealth, you are generating money from it. And so when you're generating money, therefore, zakat should be paid annually on the zakat liable amount, which is after taxes and penalty. And to give one example here, and this is the second opinion out of the five. If your retirement fund is worth 100,000, just as a theoretical example, first thing you're going to do, what is the penalty? The penalty is going to be 10%, that brings it down to 90,000. Okay, and then suppose you were to cash in that 90,000 today, and you were to add it to your balance, you were to add it to your income. What is your tax bracket? This varies from person, by the way, these are all numbers you have to decide, obviously not me. I'm giving standard examples, you have to decide. For some people, this penalty is going to be 20%. For others, it's going to be 15%. For most, it is 10%. For taxes, for some people, it'll be 35%. And for others, it's going to be 20%. So I just give a very simple example that suppose the penalty is 10% and the taxes are 20%. So from 100, we get 90. From 90, after 20%, we get 72. 2,000. So the zakat amount is going to be $1,800 on $100,000. That is fairly reasonable. That's not unreasonable. Now, suppose somebody were to say, oh, but Sheikh, I am, 58 years old. I've been working for 30 years. My 401k is 1 million and the zakat amount is 18,000 and I cannot afford $18,000. I don't have 18,000 in liquid cash. We say the following. La yukallifu Allahu nafsan illa wus'aha. Allah is not burdening you more than you can bear. You pay what you can, and you write down that in the year 2020 that I paid 10,000 in zakat and 8,000 is a debt owed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when I cash out. Okay, so in the year 2020, you paid 10,000. I'm just giving an example. Suppose you owed 18,000, you don't have that cash. So you say, we're not asking you to sell your 401k to pay zakat. No, if you don't have your liquid assets, you don't have money, we're not asking you to sell your wife's jewelry we're not asking you. Give what you can, but write down and record, and it will be a debt owed to Allah when you cash out. And so when you cash out $1 million, okay, now you deserve to give 8,000 that was due for that 2020 year, and then you can add whatever is left. So you pay what you can of that amount, and whatever you cannot pay, you just make a note of it, and you keep on adding it until you actually do cash out. And then when you do cash out from that, mashallah, large pool, and again, this will only gonna apply when you have a massive amount. We already discussed the average 401k, 100-150,000 across North America. And that we just calculated for you, $1,800 is $1,900 roughly, could be less than this depending on the penalty and the taxes. And that's fairly reasonable. And you don't have to pay in one go. You can take it out over a few months. So for example, when Ramadan comes, you calculate, let's say that your 401k has 2,500 in zakah. You're like, I don't have that cash on me. No problem. Every month, give 500, 300 every month give, and inshallah ta'ala, as you give, you will see the barakah in your wealth as well. So to conclude this question, and I know I went into a lot of detail, but I was asked this by so many people, and really it deserves its own lecture. To conclude, there is no question that zakat is owed on investments, and to say otherwise really means that a massive fortune, a massive amount of wealth will simply just be accruing more and more wealth, and the haqq of the fuqara will not be given unto them. I don't agree with the fatwa to say that do not give zakat at all. I used to say 10 years ago that zakat should not be given because I read fatwa from Shaykh Qardawi and others. We respect them immensely, but of course their fatwa were dealing with the Middle East, and they are not dealing with the 401k. And what confuses the people who read, including me, it says the fatwa of retirement funds. But the retirement funds they are talking about are not the 401ks here in America. And so I don't think that those fatwa can apply over here. I think that it is very clear that there is ownership over the wealth. If there is ownership, zakat must be given. How much zakat is given? There are two major opinions out there. Either you give zakat on the amount that is accessible to you, which is position number two, or you follow the other fatwa, which is a well-known fatwa, and I respect that immensely, and I don't have a problem if somebody were to follow that fatwa, which would essentially say that you take one-third of the amount, and whichever fatwa you follow, you follow one based upon the sheikh that you trust. And between these two, what I say is that the second fatwa, which is that you pay zakat on the full amount that is accessible to you, will bring about more barakah in your life and more purity of your wealth. And when you give to Allah, Allah will give back unto you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless each and every one of us with rizq that is halal and rizq that is wasi' and rizq that is mubarak. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to continue to increase our rizq, but not to make the rizq our ultimate goal. We ask Allah to allow our rizq to be a stepping stone that we can use to earn His pleasure and to gain Jannah. And inshaAllah ta'ala, we will continue our Q&A next week. Until then, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
قد أفلح المؤمنون الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون والذين هم للزكاة فاعلون والذين هم لفروجهم حافظون إلا على أزواجهم أو ما ملكت أيمانهم فإنهم غير ملومين.